2 days past 18, he was waiting for the bus in his army green, sat down in a booth.
Good morning and welcome. My name is Ron Griffin. I'm the Veteran Service Officer and a member of the American Legion here in town, and also on the Medfield High School Plaque Committee. Today, we honor those students who attended high school in this building and later went off to serve in our armed forces in Vietnam era. Let me be very clear, we are not honoring war, this war or any war. We honor those men and those women who came to the aid of their country. Yesterday was Flag Day, so we also want to honor our 236th birthday of the flag. As we bring out a flag, I would like to remind all veterans that they can render the hand salute during the national anthem or not, whether you are covered or uncovered. And this is, I remind them because of recent changes in legislation that altered what is appropriate for our behavior with the American flag. So, if everyone will arise, we'll do the national anthem.
Broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. O'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still
At this time, I'd like to ask Eagle Scout Sam Marble if he would come and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance of the flag. And for this, I ask everyone to take off their hat and place their hands over their heart.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now the chorus will sing America the Beautiful.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains' majesties, above thy fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
This memorial is the realization of Sam Marble's vision, dream that he was inspired by his uncle, Richard Pond. He came to our committee with the concept of a memorial honoring those who attended the school and went on to serve in the armed forces during the Vietnam War. His Eagle Scout project consisted of providing the place for the memorial committee to erect the memorial. He became a partner with the committee. He raised funds. He coordinated the construction of the patio area, which will frame the memorial. Please welcome Sam Marble.
So, good morning, everyone. As you just heard, I am Sam Marble, and as you now know, my Eagle Project, which working in conjunction with the town and some scouts, was to build the stone patio, which currently resides right in front of this middle school. This patio, while somewhat aesthetically pleasing, it is a nice place for students to gather at the end of the day, currently serves a completely different purpose, to provide a home for a Vietnam Veterans Memorial, while still providing a place for students to gather. This memorial houses a granite stone with a bronze plaque mounted on it, listing the names of the veterans who served during the Vietnam era that went through the Medfield school system. When I was first tasked with figuring out what I wanted to do for my Eagle Project, I knew that I wanted to dedicate my project to the veterans. After all, the men and women who put their lives in danger to protect and to shape this country ought to be recognized for their service. After thinking for a while about what I would do, I spoke with my uncle, whom, having just heard of my idea behind a project, decided to come forward with some information he had never shared with me before. He began telling me about his experience in the Vietnam War, specifically about how every soldier was treated upon returning home. He described how, instead of returning as heroes, as their fathers and grandfathers once had, the soldiers of the Vietnam War looked down upon, called warmongers, and treated as murderers. This struck me. How could someone who volunteered their life for their country, or was forced to do so by the draft, be treated so horribly? After all, they were only carrying out orders. It was at that point I became inspired to dedicate my project to the veterans of the Vietnam War and the boys who never came home. As a note, I was very fortunate that my Uncle Richie was able to attend the initial plaque dedication ceremony on Veterans Day. However, he passed away this spring and is thus unable to make it today. Continuing. A little while later, I met with Superintendent McGuire to discuss putting a memorial on school grounds. It just so happened that on that day, he was about to meet with the Medfield Veterans Plaque Committee and invited me to tag along. It was at this meeting that I was introduced to the initiative to place plaques at each school in order to commemorate the veterans who went through each of the schools and for the service in the wars that they fought in. At the time, they were just finishing the bronze plaque at the Dale Street School, and were just about to consider starting the next plaque here at the Blake Middle School. They did run into a small problem. Where would they put this plaque? At Dale Street, they had a nice wall to mount the plaque, but here, that was not an option. That's where I came into play. I volunteered my design of the patio around the flagpole to be used by the committee to place their memorial to the veterans of the Vietnam War who had gone through the Medfield schools. I was inspired. I was finally helping to recognize those who had shaped this country. Now, over a year later, after working with the Medfield Veterans Plaque Committee, the town, my troop, and everyone else who has helped, my Eagle Project is finished, and I am also proud to stand here today to introduce you all to the dedication ceremony of this now complete memorial. Thank you.
I'd like to introduce a few people in the audience, if I can. I see Commander Candler of the American Legion is here. I see Richard DeSorga someplace. There he is. Selectman. He's also part of the our committee. And I'd like to recognize Bob McGuire, too, who's part of our committee. And under his leadership, I think we've done a great job in just short 3 years erecting 3 memorials around town. As you know, he's retiring soon, so this will be his last time to talk. He doesn't want to talk, but if we could give him a round of applause. Now I'd like to introduce Senator Timmelty, and he's going to talk to you. He's been, since 2005, he's been our senator, and thank you very much for coming.
Good morning. Thank you very much, Ron. A very special day in a very special community. And Sam, what an extraordinary Eagle Project. And as I think of it, as the nephew of a junior officer who served in combat in Vietnam, I feel a very special kinship to what you encountered and what you encumbered. And when you think of it at your age, to think so much of the veterans, and I think it speaks so much about this wonderful town and its great school system, leadership in that school system, and those that make it up. As I had the pleasure to be at your Veterans Day ceremony this past fall, and it was an extraordinarily moving ceremony, as we live here in the greatest country the world has ever seen. And the reason that it was those who had paid the ultimate sacrifice. On Memorial Day and Veterans Day, we make certain that we remember those. But certainly having a plaque here with all the names of those who bravely served us and the two who sadly didn't come back lends us to appreciate, fully appreciate, what we're blessed with in this country and how we got there, how this country was created at great sacrifice, and how it continues to grow and thrive. It's through the sacrifice of those men and women who serve us bravely and even now serve us in harm's way, defending our way of life. And that we never forget them is important for us as we move forward. And I think as I saw the full participation of the school system in that moving Veterans Day ceremony, I truly felt blessed and indeed inspired. This is a very special community, and how does that community? It's the individuals who put so much into it. Eagle projects like Sam's, and we heard of one in a meeting yesterday morning in the cemetery of Eagle projects of the Boy Scouts. These very strong troops here that churn out Eagles, the pinnacle of youth. And what they mean to this. And it's the leadership of their teachers, the leadership of the selectmen, and the leadership of the parents that gets that done. And here you are on Flag Day when everybody else is doing much of everything else. And here we are remembering our veterans, particularly remembering two who didn't come back, and certainly honoring the youth who do so much and still, amongst all the distractions, can still remember and do something this special. So it's a privilege to be here. It's a privilege to represent you. May God bless the town of Medfield, and may God bless the United States of America. Thank you.
Thank you. Denise Garlick is here, and she's our representative. Would she please come up?
Thank you for these few moments to share something from my heart. I am part of the legislative delegation under the leadership of Senator Jim Timilty, and his words are so appropriate for this gathering here. But I wanted to share with you two stories. I, in the probably late 80s, had visited the Washington Vietnam Soldiers Memorial with a fellow nurse of mine. And we stood there at 8 o'clock in the morning, and it was very few people were there. And she was gazing at those names. And as we walked away, both really filled with the sense of loss of the Vietnam veterans who had died, she said to me, "You know, I always believed that his name was here." And I said, "Whose name?" And she said, "You know, the man I should have married." She was bright and beautiful, compassionate, and single. And she had always felt that that tremendous loss of what had happened during that time of Vietnam was this loss of a whole generation of people who had served and who had died. And it struck me how incalculable that loss is. I later, some of you may know, I'm a registered nurse. I was a VA nurse for many years, and I cared for the veterans from the Vietnam War era. And it was always heartbreaking to me that the other veterans who were so connected to each other and cared for each other, and the Vietnam War veterans held themselves apart, and they were shattered in so many ways. And I thought when the time came and both Senator Timilty and I were here for the memorial here in Medfield for the Vietnam War veterans through the work of Sam Marble, I thought it was such an important moment and such a healing moment. And I wish that it was happening in every town of the Commonwealth and in every state of our nation. So today we honor our Vietnam War veterans and all those who served in that time. We honor the young people like Sam Marble and the people like Bob McGuire and their leadership allowing all of this to happen. And I honor everyone in Medfield who's part of this today, and thank you for it.
Thank you, Denise. Many of you are aware that last November, during the Vietnam Day ceremony here at Blake Middle School, students dedicated the plaque itself. This past year has been an exciting journey for several of the veterans whose name appears on this plaque. We heard first from Frank Iafola, who is past commander of the American Legion. And in March, Al Manganiello was presented the Medfield Foundation's Volunteer Lifetime Achievement Award. And in recognition, in Memorial Day, we heard from Jeff Cook. And now today, we're going to hear from Jim Blake. Jim is the son of Thomas A. Blake, for who this school is named after. Thomas Blake was a World War II veteran, and many of his artifacts are on display in the building. He became superintendent of schools in 1957 and promptly advanced solving the town's recent student population by building this school, which was dedicated in 1961 and named the Medfield Junior-Senior High School. All of the veterans honored today attended the school. Jim graduated from school in 1965 and went on to graduate with honors from Boston College, after which he enlisted as an officer in the Army and served in Kansas and Germany. His wife Jane is also a Medfield High School graduate, and they lived here in Medfield until 1979. And they departed in favor of a lake region in Londonderry, New Hampshire. In retirement, he has been heavily involved with the host of charitable and nonprofit organizations, including St. Mark's Parish in Londonderry, the Knights of Columbus, Students for Scholars, the David Wood Memorial Golf Tournament for ALS, and a driver for community caregivers. He has also coached youth sports and founded Londonderry's American Legion baseball program in 1996. A member of Londonderry's American Legion Post, where he has served as finance officer, adjutant, and judge advocate, please welcome James Blake.
Thank you, Ron. And young Mr. Marble, you've done a wonderful thing. Thank you. If you have to go, you ought to go first class. It was the summer of 1965, shortly after I graduated from right here. And the Medfield experience prepared me excellently for entering Boston College. But what was going through my mind was, what do I do about Vietnam? It was starting to really heat up there. If you remember, under President Kennedy, we had 15,000 advisors in country in support of the South Vietnamese government and its military. But after the Gulf of Tonkin resolution was approved by Congress, President Johnson and Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara escalated America's efforts by putting over 500,000 troops on the ground, almost on a permanent basis, and rotated hundreds of thousands of people through there, many of whom we see here today. So the question I had for my father was, you, Dad, as a World War II veteran, as a continued reservist in the United States Navy, while you're still superintendent of schools here, what would you advise me to do? And his answer was, if you've got to go, you ought to go first class. So getting ready to be trained by Jesuit fathers, just like he was, when he spoke in parables, sometimes I was able to understand him. And what he meant was, when your country calls, you must respond in an affirmative way. And if you can, serve as an officer. So that's what I did. I enrolled in Army ROTC upon entering Boston College in September 1965. And I can tell you, it was not easy being at ROTC. There are 3 classes a week for 4 years and 1 hour of drills every week. And on drill day, you had to wear your cadet uniform, traditional Army greens. And unlike at the Naval Academy, when you wore Army greens on a northeastern campus, you were a lightning rod in the late 60s, including Boston College. It was not fun being protested at by your own classmates. And most of the summer after junior was spent in basic training. For me, it was not Fort Devens. It was Indian Town Gap Military Reservation near Hershey, Pennsylvania, instead of the beach with my girlfriend, who was Jane at the time. She is my wife. She's here today. But I survived, and I was commissioned upon graduation in May of 1969 from Boston College. And my dad swore me in. It was a very proud day for both of us, me and my Army Greens, with one gold bar on, and him in his Navy khakis with commander's insignia on. Like any parent would be, he was worried I was worried. Like me and most people involved, he wished that the Vietnam War never happened. We both thought it would have been over by then. And by that time, the cost to our country was enormous, on its way to more than 58,400 troops killed, more than 305,000 troops wounded, and along with our nation questioning why we're even there, supporting a corrupt South Vietnamese government at a time when we were not even attacked ourselves. In comparison to those 58,400 plus, there have been 7,000 killed in the Gulf War, Iraq, and Afghanistan combined. That puts things in perspective. After starting my career in the computer industry with IBM, I began my two-year active duty obligation with the Army in the fall. I was ultimately assigned to the 1st Infantry Division, a NATO committed unit, having returned from Vietnam, and was headquartered at Fort Riley, Kansas. In the fall of 1970, I participated in Operation Reforger II in southern Germany, which was a series of exercises in support of that unit's NATO commitment to be ready within 24 hours' notice to respond upon Soviet attack of any NATO member. It wasn't great, but I wasn't going to complain, believe me. I wasn't being shot at in Vietnam like many of you were. I worked the graveyard shift from 8 p.m. until 8 a.m. Worked all night, no sleep. Slept in an unheated tent during the day when I could. Caught the flu from the flu shot they gave me. Ate sea rations out of a can, cold. I knew it was a good day when I got Franks and beans, and I knew it was a bad day when I got the dreaded ham with water added, with lima beans on the side. You remember those. We convoyed during the day, my sleep time, in an open Jeep. But it was hard to sleep in an open Jeep when you're passed by an assistant division commander, a brigadier general, who asks you, what are you doing sleeping on the job? That happened. And also awoken many times by hailstones clanging off my steel pot. I couldn't wait to get home and tell Dad about all these great first-class accommodations I had in the Army. Going first class? I don't know about that. But I wasn't going to complain. All in all, I had it pretty easy. I really did. And after completing my obligation in 1971, I returned to IBM and continued my career in the computer industry. Like everyone whose name on this memorial, I wrote out a blank check payable to the United States of America in an amount of anything and everything up to and including my life. Serving during the Vietnam War era was a sign of one's character. All of us listed here answered our country's call and did the right thing when it was very difficult to do so. Because we all know many of our peers who did everything they could to avoid serving. That's a sign of their character too. When interviewing people for a job or asking questions of political candidates, and living in New Hampshire, we see them quite often, as you can imagine, I often made it a point to ask about their military experience. I thought it was a sign of their character. And what they did about Vietnam. Some were proud veterans, but many squirmed. So I suggest that you try it, especially with politicians. So while thanking everyone listed on the memorial, I want to give special recognitions to all those who actually fought in Vietnam. And it's expressed best by one of my favorite presidents, Theodore Roosevelt, in a speech he gave in France, in Paris, in 1910. And it's called The Man in the Arena. It goes like this. It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short and short again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does valiantly strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. So those of you today who are here and all those listed on that memorial who fought in Vietnam are the true heroes among us today and forever. Our country still owes you a debt of gratitude. You served so bravely and courageously under the most difficult of conditions. Terrible heat and humidity, insects, Agent Orange. The movie Good Morning Vietnam said there's nothing like the smell of napalm in the morning. I guess that's true. With our country's support eroding greatly, the longer we were there in that quagmire, the faster that support eroded. You dealt with a mission that was undefined and confusing. You had rules of engagement that were unfair and restrictive. When meeting civilians, you didn't know if they were a friend or foe, including women or children. A lot of them worked for Charlie. You had to use tactics, guerrilla warfare tactics. They were never used before in the history of American soldiers. You had an exit strategy that was non-existent. Peace with honor? Are you kidding me? There was no peace with honor ever in Vietnam. And when you came home, you weren't greeted with a hero's welcome. Nobody even threw a parade for you, ever. Some of you were even advised not to wear your uniform in the airport so as to avoid being hassled. Some of you had to fight with the Veterans Administration to get proper medical treatment. Decades later, some are still fighting to receive proper treatment for conditions caused by Agent Orange and other defoliating agents in Vietnam. And sadly, some are still fighting the symptoms of PTSD. Yes, the costs of the Vietnam War were enormous to our country and to many who fought there. To you, I say thank you and welcome home. Please join me. Welcome home, guys. Welcome home. You are the heroes among us today. On another memorial rock, it is written, not everyone who lost his life in Vietnam died there, and not everyone who came home from Vietnam ever left there. We all know one or more people who came home from Vietnam with terrible physical or mental problems or both that had major negative impacts on their lives. Two friends and former teammates of mine right here were afflicted so badly that their lives were ruined. Mike Donahue and Jim McNichol were never the same after serving in Vietnam. They suffered enormously and died prematurely in very tragic ways. No, their names are not among the 58,000 plus on the Vietnam Wall in Washington, but they might as well be because they lost their lives there. Please join me in a moment of remembrance for Mike and Jim and all those you knew who suffered a similar fate. Finally, two of our own and two of our best were killed in action in Vietnam, Steve Hinckley and Peter Christoph. Rather than being honored with all of us today while being surrounded by their families, perhaps their children, and having the thrill of grandchildren here, they lay in hallowed ground at Vine Lake Cemetery here in Medfield. They paid the ultimate price while serving their country more than 43 years ago. It's hard to believe. Their losses remain painful to their families, friends, and all those who knew them. They were good young men, 19, 20 years old. I conclude my remarks by asking you to rise as I read the first two stanzas of TAPS. Thanks and praise for our days, 'neath the sun, 'neath the stars, 'neath the sky as we go. This we know, God is nigh. Day is done, gone the sun, from the lake, from the hill, from the sky, all is well. Safely rest, God is nigh. And when you visit the cemetery to visit and remember your friends and parents and grandparents, please stop by Steve's and Peter's grave sites. Thank them. Let them know that they will never, ever be forgotten.
John, thank you, Jim. So I did notice in today we have in attendance some of the Hinckley family, some of the Kristoff family. I also see Chief Meany back there, and Chief, why does this happen now that I have a moment? Chief Kingsbury, and I saw Pete Peterson, our other selectman, and somewhere he's taking pictures, and also, there he is, and also I heard from Mark Fisher, who couldn't be here today, third selectman. There are 144 names on this memorial. Each of these veterans has a different service experience. What they all have in common is that they wear the National Department Service Medal, Defense Medal, that I also wear today. The medal is not difficult to earn, but is significant in it means they served during a time of conflict, ready to go wherever they were needed, and agreed to obey the orders of the President of the United States, as well as the officers appointed over them. Obey is the operative word, as sometimes that involves doing what you may not want to do. While many did serve in Vietnam, others were needed elsewhere throughout the world, or perhaps right here at home. Those who served in direct conflicts have been changed forever, sometimes because of their physical wounds, but more often by the memories that simply will not go away. Many of those on this memorial have endured much suffering, both physical and mental, as a result of their service, and too paid the ultimate sacrifice. The numbers are staggering, with a total count of 58,282 having died as a result of the injuries received during the Vietnam War. Over 300,000 received physical wounds, and an incalculable number suffered from PTSD, TBI, and the various diseases associated with Agent Orange. During the year of 1968, when Stephen Hinckley was killed in action, so were 16,588 others. That's more than 45 Americans per day. When Peter Kristoff was killed in action in 1969, there were 11,613 others. Almost every one of us can personally identify with someone who has suffered or died as a result of their participation in the Vietnam War. All the students and most of the staff here at Blake Middle School experienced that firsthand during the plaque dedication last November, when they heard the story of Deborah Manning. Everyone was overwhelmed to learn that her father was killed in Vietnam when she was just 3 years old. Life must go on, we must persevere, yet we must not forget. So if we would all stand, I would like to have one more moment of silence, which will be followed by taps. And now I'd like to invite all those veterans whose name appears on this memorial, if they would come up for the unveiling. I know we have a few here. So it's been trying to unveil itself all morning. So let's hope it goes well now. If you all just grab a piece of it, then you can kind of give it a ho, heave-ho. Come on, if you can just circle around. Thank you. Okay, we're ready. On three. One, two, three. Now the memorial is uncovered, it'll be placed in the custody of the students who attend school here, now, and in the future, who walk these halls, who learn in these classrooms, and play in these grounds. To accept stewardship of the, on behalf of them, is principal of the Blake Middle School, Nat Vaughn.
Good morning. It is a true privilege and pleasure to be a part of this ceremony and dedication of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial here at Blake. I'm honored to be here representing Blake Middle School and the Blake community today with our veterans and our many guests. This past November, as you've heard, as we entered Veterans Day weekend, we gathered as a school community to dedicate the memorial plaque. At that assembly, I shared President Obama's Declaration of Veterans Day from last November. On days like this, we are called to reflect on immeasurable burdens that have been borne by so few. We pay tribute to our wounded, our missing, our fallen, and their families. Men and women who have known the true costs of conflict and deserve our deepest respect now and forever. We also remember that our commitments to those who have served are commitments we must honor not only on Veterans Day, but every day. Here today, I am pleased that we have been able to take time this morning to carry forth this work as we recognize and thank our veterans for this service. I'm proud, honored, and humbled to be a part of this assembly and dedication. Each year at Blake, we select a theme that we want to emphasize with our students and community, a skill or trait that we believe is important. Last year's theme was community, and our theme for the Blake community this year is perseverance. I believe that today is the culmination of and an appreciation of these two traits, how the Medfield community has truly come together to honor our veterans as they have and continue to embody the essence and the core of perseverance. At this time, I'd like to make a few special acknowledgments. First, I want to thank Mike Sullivan, our town administrator, for coming today. I also want to recognize the Department of Public Works of Medfield. Bob Kennedy Jr. is here today and helped a great deal in making sure that the plaque was in a lovely place. I want to thank our Veterans Committee. It has been a real honor and a joy to work with Lee Treadway, Richard DeSorga, Tony Centauri, Ron Griffin, Nancy Kelly Lavin, and Bob McGuire. Thank you. I'd be remiss if I did not distinctly recognize Bob, as Ron said earlier, for his leadership of this committee. I thank you, Bob, for inviting me to be part of this important work, and we will miss your presence and guidance. Thank you. Sam, I commend you for your work and initiative. To our entire community, it is my hope that you have been touched by the stories you have heard throughout the year, and that you will take the initiative to introduce yourself and say thank you when you see our veterans. And finally, to all of our veterans and families who are here today, thank you. We cannot say that enough. On behalf of Blake Middle School, it is my honor and privilege to accept the stewardship of this memorial. The question we have focused on with our students throughout the year, and the one we should continue to keep in mind each year, not only on Veterans Day, or on Memorial Day, or on Flag Day, but throughout the year, is as follows. What can we do for our veterans so they never go unrecognized nor underappreciated? Again, it's simple. We can say thank you. Please join me in one more round of applause as we thank our veterans for their service. Thank you.
I want to thank you all for coming today. We're going to close out the ceremony here today with another selection from the choir, and we hope you all join us along as they sing It's a Grand Old Flag.
You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, and forever in peace may you wave. You're the emblem of the land I love, the home of the free and the brave. Every heart beats true for the red, white, and blue, where there's never a boast or brag. Should an old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag.
That concludes our ceremony. Thank you very much for attending. You're all invited back into the cafeteria for a brief drink or I think a snack. Thank you very much for attending.
Production support provided by Medfield.tv. Access to our community.
Hi, I'm Mike Sullivan, and you're watching Medfield.tv.